The flush mode defines when new entities and your changes on existing ones get written to the database. This might seem like a simple and obvious mechanism, but I recognized in my Q&A calls that it often causes some confusion because by default Hibernate doesn't perform a flush when you call the persist method on your entity manager or the save method on your Spring Data JPA repository. It also doesn't only perform a flush at the end of the transaction, even though this is an important and guaranteed trigger of a flush operation. The specific flush handling depends on the combination of the configured flush mode, the type of operations you are executing, and some Hibernate-specific optimizations. I'll explain all of that in this video. Hi, I'm Torben Janssen. If you want to build incredible efficient persistence layers with Hibernate and Spring Data JPA, please subscribe and click the bell to get new videos every week. And also don't forget to like this video if you found it helpful. The JPA specification only defines the flush mode types auto and commit. Hibernate extends this by adding the flush mode types always and manual. Let's take a closer look at all four modes. The flush mode type auto is supported by the JPA specification and Hibernate. JPA defines it as the default flush mode. It flushes the persistence context in two situations: before the transaction gets committed and before executing a query that uses any database table for which your persistence context contains any pending changes. Flushing the persistence context before the transaction gets committed should be obvious and not require any deeper explanation. But the second situation is a little more complex and requires you to know how Hibernate determines which database tables a query affects. This is based on the query space I explained in a previous video. For every JPQL or criteria query, Hibernate generates the SQL statement. It therefore knows which database tables are used in the query. Hibernate can use that when performing a dirty check on all entity objects in the current persistence context. If it finds a dirty entity mapped to one of the tables referenced by the query, it needs to flush these changes to the database. Let's take a look at an example. Here you can see a simple test case that persists a new chess player entity before it selects all chess tournament entities in the first, and the chess player with the first name Magnus in the second query. Let's run this test case and check the doc output. As you can see here, Hibernate doesn't flush the new chess player entity before it executes the query that selects all chess tournament entities. That query doesn't reference the chess player table, and the new chess player will not affect the query result. Hibernate can therefore delay the insert statement's execution, which might create some performance benefits. But that changes when Hibernate selects a chess player with the first name Magnus. That JPQL query references the chess player table, and Hibernate doesn't know if the new chess player entity will affect the query result. It therefore flushes the entity and generates an SQL insert statement for it before it executes the query. It gets a little more complex if you execute a native SQL query. As I explained in my guide to Hibernate's query spaces, Hibernate can't determine which tables a native SQL query uses. You should therefore register the query space for each native query. Otherwise, Hibernate isn't able to decide if it needs to flush the persistence context. It therefore flushes the persistence context to ensure that the query returns the correct results. You can see an example of this here. This time I persist a new chess player entity and execute two native SQL queries that select all chess tournament entities. For the first one, I register the chess tournament entity as the query space. And for the second one, I don't register the query space. As you can see in the log output, the first query doesn't trigger a flush of the new chess player entity. Hibernate checked the query space and knew that the new chess player entity isn't relevant for this native query. But the second query triggered a flush. This is the same query statement as the previous one, but I didn't register the query space. Due to that, Hibernate didn't know if the query referenced the chess player table and had to flush the new entity. The flush mode type commit requires a flush before committing the transaction, but doesn't define what needs to happen before executing a query. When using Hibernate 5 or 6, executing any query doesn't flush any pending changes. You can see that when we execute this test case. It persists a new chess player before selecting all chess player entities from the database. The JPQA query that selects all chess player entities doesn't cause a flush of the newly persisted chess player entity. Due to that, the player isn't part of the query result. The FlushMode type always is Hibernate-specific and tells Hibernate to flush the persistence context before committing the transaction and before executing a query. Using this mode, Hibernate doesn't check if the flush is required and handles all types of queries in the same way. Let's give this a try. I persist a new chess player entity before selecting all chess tournament entities from the database. The new player doesn't change the query result, and the flush wouldn't be necessary. But because I configured flush mode type always, Hibernate flushes the persistence context anyways. The flush mode type manual is the second Hibernate-specific mode. It deactivates all automatic flushes and requires the application to trigger the flushes programmatically. I use that in this test case when persisting a new chess player, selecting all chess player entities from the database, and flushing the persistence context. I deactivated all automatic flushes, and the JPQA query no longer caused a flush of the newly persisted chess player entity. Due to that, the player isn't part of the query result and doesn't get flushed until I call the entity manager flush method. I don't recommend using flush mode type manual. It creates a high risk that you miss flushing some changes to the database or that some of your queries don't use the latest changes. Some teams try to use it to improve the performance of their persistence layer, but in almost all cases, delaying the flush operation only improves the performance if you implement your persistence layer in the wrong way. It only hides performance issues instead of solving it. Considering the high risk that this flush mode introduces, I recommend fixing these performance problems instead of hiding them. This usually doesn't require more work than implementing and testing the manual flush handling. After I showed you the effect of each flush mode, it's time to talk about its configuration. You can configure the flush mode globally or set it for each database query. This enables you to define a standard flush mode for your application and override it for a specific query. You can set the standard flush mode for your application by configuring the property org.hibernate.flushmode in your persistence.xml file. By default, the flush mode is set to auto, and I recommend you don't change it. The way you can configure a query-specific flush mode depends on the flush mode type you want to set. If you want to use the flush mode types auto or commit, which are defined by the JPA specification, you can call the setFlushMode method on your query or type query interface. If you want to use a Hibernate-specific flush mode, you need to use Hibernate session to create your query and call its setHibernateFlushMode method. And as you already saw in the section on flush mode type manual, you can trigger a flush programmatically by calling the EntityManager.flush method. If you're using flush mode type auto or commit, this should only be necessary if you use a JPQL or criteria query to perform a bulk update or remove operations. Hibernate's automatic flush handling is easier to use and more efficient in almost all other cases. The flush mode defines when your persistence provider flushes new and changed entities to the database. Based on the JPA specification, it can either do that automatically before executing a query and before committing the transaction, or only before committing the transaction. Hibernate supports two additional flush modes that you can use to flush the persistence context before every query, or to manage the flushes programmatically and deactivate all automatic flushes. I recommend using flush mode type auto for all persistence layers. It avoids the risk that you might miss flushing a pending change or that a query works on outdated data, and Hibernate provides its own optimization based on the query space to avoid any unnecessary flushes. Okay, that's it for today. If you want to learn more about Hibernate and JPA, you should join the Persistence Hub. It gives you access to all my video courses, including one about Hibernate performance tuning, 2 monthly Q&A calls, monthly coding challenges, a community of like-minded developers, and regular expert sessions. And if you liked today's video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe below. Bye!